Arr, pirate fans. It's time to find out the state of the ship of your defending champions for the 2022 season with your hosts, Johnny Wilbur and Jake Ignaszewski. And now, brought to you by Resonate, it's the state of the ship.
Welcome back into the state of the ship, and there's a lot that goes on to the state of the ship. My name's Johnny Wilbur. This is Jake Ignaszewski, and first, we're going to start a little bit of telling you not only about the Mass Pirates and how they come to be the champions of the IFL last year in the United Bowl, but there's a lot that goes into being into the championship game and getting into the championship and building a championship team, and there's a lot behind the scenes that does that as well. And Jake, your first season here with the Mass Pirates, tell us a little bit about yourself here on this state of the ship.
Absolutely. So I'm the team insider for the Pirates. I most recently graduated from Plymouth State University this past May with a sports management degree and communications minor. This past summer, I was a sideline reporter for a collegiate baseball team called the Nashville Silver Knights. But I just have a big passion of, you know, not only reporting about teams, but, you know, getting to interview players, coaches, front office representatives as well, as and sort of hear how they build up the team, especially with the Pirates, with how successful they were last year. It's been really interesting to hear, you know, everything that happens behind the scenes, like you mentioned, John.
Have you been to an IFL game before? Have you ever been to an indoor football league game?
I haven't, unfortunately. I'm really excited for the season to start. We actually did a tour of the DCU Center a few weeks ago, and I kind of got chills when I was in there. I was really excited to, you know, see everything that goes on during game day. I've watched a few games from last year with the Pirates, and seeing the, obviously, the rule changes compared to the NFL, it makes it so much more exciting, because anything can really happen. You know, a team can come back even with, you know, a minute left, 30 seconds left. And it's something where it doesn't matter, you know, how far away a team is or how much of a drought they have to come back from. You know, the game isn't fully over until those three zeros hit.
That's for sure. And it's really an exciting game. And as we talked to Jawad last week, one of the things that it's been explained to me as far as is red zone football the entire time, inside with boards that are in play all the time. Some of the wide receivers, Jake, I don't know that I've seen any hockey players take some of the hits into the boards that these guys do. They lay out and really give their all for every play, and it shows out there. It shows in the crowd. The crowd's right on top of the team, and the team really feeds off that too. It's really exciting to be in the arena and to be a part of the Indoor Football League, and especially with the Mass Pirates on the road that they were on last year. Everybody had that feeling in the arena that things, you know, were going well. So for myself, the reason I know these things in the arena, Jake, is I'm the voice of the arena, of the Mass Pirates. When they come onto the field and when you hear the pirate man talking, that's, that'd be me. I be the pirate of the Massachusetts. And you know, I'm not as good looking as Arthur, but, you know, and it's all of these people that make the Mass Pirates who they are. It's Arthur. It's behind the scenes. It's ticket sales. And we're going to talk a lot about that on the state of the ship. And, as I said, I am the voice of the arena in the arena on game day. I also host an afternoon drive show on 101.3 MyFM out of Milford, Mass. And we are in the heart of it all, is what we like to say, and in between Worcester, Boston, and Providence. So I get a good feel for the sportsmanship around us, and I've been involved in the sports for a long time, of course, you know, with the Woo Sox and the Railers and everybody that's been in the Worcester League, and just coming into the Mass Pirates was the next big fit, and I couldn't be happier to be a part of this team. And I know that, Jake, you are gonna love this thing. I've been in, you know, sports and in radio for about 25 years now, so you're the young guy, but you're the smart guy. You got all these stats and all these things, and I look forward to being able to pick your brain. And I love being able to work with someone as young and as enthusiastic as yourself about professional sports and about making a part of being a part of professional sports. And wait till you get to talk to Patrick Pass, head coach Patrick Pass, three-time Super Bowl champion Patrick Pass. If you do, let me know, because I get to say hi at the rally. That's about it. Pat does not, he's not very good, very much into interviews. I did get a chance many years ago. He ran a charity softball game, I believe, with the Patriots and some of the Red Sox players, former players, and I had a chance on air to talk to him and do a brief interview. But even throughout all last year, he's very camera shy, he's very microphone shy, but very football smart, and that's where it all starts, and it comes from the top down. And Jake, I think you're really going to enjoy being a part of the Pirates and being a part of the ship. So you're kind of one of the new signings as well, as we start the new podcast here, the State of the Ship, and we're going to talk about some of the new signings that have come on in the past couple of weeks, in the past couple of months, as we're about 17 deep right now.
Yeah. Well, it's really interesting to see how Jawad has really built up this team. Not only brought back a lot of the key contributors from the 2021 championship team, not only, some of the guys on the offensive side, Alejandro Benefield, Thomas Owens, Martez Carter. And then also looking on the defensive side as well, guys who were such key contributors to that number one defense in the IFL last year with Chucky Williams, Harlan Miller. It's going to be really interesting to see, how all these guys all mold together. But, like John mentioned, the Pirates made two really interesting moves during this past week. We can first start off with wide receiver T.O. Redding, which we've kind of joked around the office a little bit. It's going to be interesting to see how his teammates are able to sort of decipher Thomas Owens and now T.O. Redding.
Well, and as the PA guy who gets to call out the touchdowns when Thomas Owens receives so many of them, and I quickly, nicknamed him. I knew he was named T.O. before that, but in front of the crowd, and we gave him that T.O. because it was a little different than the original way of the T.O. So you had the Thomas Owens, and it just rang, and it rings out in the arena. So now how are we going to work with T.O. Redding when he receives a touchdown?
Maybe. It's going to be really interesting, because I was watching his highlights, not only from the few games that he played in preseason football with the Detroit Lions. For fans that don't know, T.O. Redding played for three different teams in 2018 in the National Football League, the Detroit Lions, as well as the Green Bay Packers and the Washington Football Team. But when he was at...
Are they the Generals now?
Red Wolves.
The Red Wolves. Oh, they changed it again. I thought I heard this morning it was going to be the Generals.
Yeah, they're the Red Wolves. But watching T.O.'s his highlights at Bowling Green University, this guy makes so many contested catches. It doesn't matter if he's double-teamed, triple-teamed. He just makes these acrobatic catches. And there was even one of them where I got a flashback from when Thomas Owens made a one-handed catch last season. T.O. Redding did the same exact thing during his collegiate career. And throughout my entire time watching his highlights, it was tough not to have my jaw wide open.
The IFL is full of guys that have not only had a cup of coffee in the NFL and some of the other leagues around, but have spent a lot of time there, have floated around, have been on the practice squads, have done, gone through the college leagues, and there's a lot of talent. And the more you get to see, the more the teams that come in, and the more time you spend watching IFL football, you see the talent. And it takes a special kind of talent to be able to play indoor football. And you see that right up front, of course. And, getting Toby Johnson back up front, that was a big one for me. I really like Toby. Again, I love to call him out because he's always on the tackle. A big sack by Toby Johnson is something that really gets the crowd rolling. But, the offensive line has to be so tight and so sure, because it's such a short field. Right. You got these guys out there that need a little bit of time to get open, and someone like T.O. Redding, I think, is going to really thrive in this program.
I completely agree. I just want to mention something as well. During our first episode, was with Toby Johnson. I had the opportunity to interview him, and he said that one of his goals is to be the defensive player of the year and also attempt to try and get 15 to 16 sacks this season. So I think that there's a very good chance that he'd be able to make that happen with his determination throughout this offseason. But as you mentioned, you know, a lot of these guys that play for the Pirates, not only in the IFL as well, have a lot of experience not only in the NFL, but different leagues around, you know, the XFL, the CFL, the AAF. But, you know, T.O. Redding had experience within the XFL, and it was really interesting to see sort of how he was able to maneuver around that league, playing for the New York Guardians. During his best performance he had in the XFL, he was able to make three catches for 46 yards, but unfortunately, as all of us know, the season was cut very short due to COVID-19. But the one thing that I find will be interesting with multiple wide receivers that, you know, are coming over who haven't played in the indoor league is how they're really going to be able to adapt to not only the new rule changes, but with the boards and really with the shortened field as well. Because something that I noticed with T.O. is he's got massive speed and he's a deep threat, but how is that deep threat going to work in arena football?
Yeah, and he does have that deep threat. And the good thing with T.O. is he can kind of break away. And when someone like Alejandro Benefield is throwing you the ball, we haven't even mentioned the fact that Alejandro was re-signed, and he really just sees the field really quickly, really well, gets rid of the ball fast, and can put it where it needs to be. And I think that, you know, working with T.O. like that and the way the two have already been together, I think that chemistry has really developed real well over the last year. And I think just with Redding now coming aboard, it's going to even get better. And now, you know, you talk about it, these guys, and we talked a little bit about this last week, Jake, the chemistry of this team. There's not a huge team. It's not a 60-man roster. They come together. They live here in the city of Worcester. They come from all around the country. But they come together, and they live here throughout the season, and they really become a family. And some gel, some don't, and some are here and some aren't. That's the great the greatness of the way that the league runs, and you can see it. And reading some of the things in the background of the league and of the team, they're not afraid to, you know, hey, you're not in the game plan this week, but you will be next week.
Right.
You know, everybody wants to play, but when it comes down to it, if you can put team first, and we've seen that here in New England going on for a long time, it brings championships. And I saw the Pirates put team first last year, and I think that's what really ultimately led them to that United Bowl.
I completely agree. Something that fans might not know is actually in the office is do your job. And it's something that you brought up is so keen in New England, especially with the Bill Belichick sort of do your job sort of mantra that they have. But the Pirates also made another move as well this past week, re-signing defensive lineman Deshaun Downey. And he was such a force last season.
Deshaun Downey with the sack.
And he's going to have plenty of those this next season. And it was really interesting for myself being able to see how dominant he was throughout last season. I mean, he set three records for the Pirates last season.
Yeah, he was really a beast out there. And you knew when Deshaun was on the field that he was a difference maker, and that the offense had to, you know, plan for where he was. And the quarterback always had his eye on Deshaun. His name was called out over the PA very many times. He had a lot of sacks and a lot of assists. And that's the one thing, is it's such a small field. There is less guys on the field. You get a lot of assists with these double tackles and sacks and whatnot, and especially the defensive backs coming up and making a lot of plays. We talked just a minute ago about wanting to be defensive player of the year. When you have Harlan Miller on your team, you got to check that, because Harlan is unbelievable in the backfield and really makes things happen constantly.
I completely agree, and it's also really nice as well that we're going to be able to see in 2022 some of the key guys, like you brought up Harlan in the secondary, and also, you know, Chucky Williams as well, Arian Maxey-Penton. Those guys were so key, like we talked about before, in helping the Pirates be the number one defense throughout last season. But I think with Deshaun coming back, it just brings it all back together. It's always nice, you talked about the chemistry, when you have guys who know each other well, know how to play together, and are able to have that same goal of getting back to that number one ranked defense in 2022.
Yeah, Deshaun, definitely a personality. Khalid, definitely one of the greatest personalities. And Khalid's mom, she's really awesome too. And these are the types of guys and type of families that come out. We had a big auction on the field for jerseys for charity one night last year, and the team came together. They were having fun out there, and you could see the chemistry all along, and I'm sure that Jawad's working towards that right now. And as far as the state of the ship goes, we're going to continue to bring you the up-to-date signings and all of the news, and that's what I'm really excited about, is kind of giving everybody a behind the scenes look of leading up to what, as Jawad would put, our next first championship.
Exactly. And fans are going to have the opportunity to learn more about one of the most recent signings. You talked about how important protection of the quarterback is, and you're going to have the opportunity to hear from newly signed Pirates offensive lineman Rubens Joseph in the next episode of The State of the Ship. And we really appreciate everybody who's supported us throughout the time that we've started this podcast. And for everybody who hasn't yet, make sure to subscribe on whatever audio platform that you listen to, also on YouTube as well. We also post the video version as well over there. But I'm really excited to hear about Ruben, especially he's a native guy. He's a Massachusetts guy.
Kid.
100%. He's from Springfield as well, so it'd be really cool to get that sort of hometown feel.
Speaking of that, Jake, I know a lot of people were wondering, would the Pirates have open tryouts this year? They're not needing to. They don't plan on having any open tryouts. So if you were thinking you're going to come out to the DCU Center and put on the pads and try that, not this year. Maybe in the future that's something that they'll be looking for, but they don't need to right now. They've done a great job. The war room, the scouting staff was just here outside the Resonate studio just a little while ago, and you can see that they're working hard at putting together a great team. One of the things that does happen behind the scenes, though, and one of the parts of this team and one of the parts of the ship that really makes things run, are the cheerleaders. And they just this past weekend did have tryouts. And so follow along with that. And, of course, support the girls and the guys that are out there and giving it their all, because it takes everybody. It takes a family and it takes a village to make a championship team. And that's what you see here. So that's one of the other things, Jake, that I'm really excited to bring to our fans is some of the behind the scenes stuff. We're going to talk with lots of people. I don't want to name any names right now because, I don't want them to say, well, I'm not going to go on, because you know how some people can be. But all the behind the scenes operations, the drafters, the game day operations, cameramen, and all the people who make a championship team go around, and the state of the ship, who make a ship sail.
Exactly.
The ship's got to sail.
1,000%. I'm really excited to talk to all those people and hear how they continue to help this organization become successful. And I'm really excited to have you a part of the podcast this season, John, and to update all the fans about what's going on every single week.
March 12th, opening night, we'll be there, and I can't wait to see the smile on your face, Jake, when you see the lights go out and the cameras go on and the team take the field and get that first victory of that night on opening day.
Yeah, it's going to be a magical scene, and it's going to be the first step to repeating and defending the championship. It would be awesome.
That's it. That's the state of the ship, Jake. We'll see him next week.